Hello friends, I'll be discussing the ENT questions of GT 183. Coming to question number 278, question number 278 states, treatment of CA larynx in stage 1, that is T1, N0, M0 is, here the answer is, D, that is micro laryngoscopic surgery. I know you must be having the doubts that why we are not giving the radiotherapy to the patient. My point of view is that if we do the surgery first, microlaryngoscopy, because this is a very small tumor, it is T1, N0, M0. So, the few years back there was a trend stating that there should be voice conservation. But in case of T1, even if we are doing a microlaryngoscopic surgery, there will be voice conservation. Why I am choosing microlaryngeal surgery is that radiotherapy can be given later on. Suppose if this patient develops recurrence, we can always go for radiotherapy. But first, if we give radiotherapy in T1 lesion, then doing surgery will be very difficult for us and we might compromise on the margins. So, according to me, the answer should be D, that is microlaryngoscopic surgery. Now, I'll just highlight the other stages. So, stage T1, and if the site is all sites, that is supraglottic, glottic and subglottic, the treatment is either EBRT, that is external beam radiotherapy, or microlaryngeal surgery. If it is T2, in T2 if it is glottic and subglottic, then patient must go for a radiotherapy, but if it is supraglottic, then he should go for supraglottic laryngectomy. Now, all T3 and T4 lesions, T3 and T4 all sides, we usually go for total laryngectomy. And if there is a clinically palpable lymph nodes, we go for neck dissection along with post-op radiotherapy. So, in this patient, as the patient is having T1, N0, M0, my bet will be on microlaryngoscopic surgery. The next question is, this is a pure tone audiogram, which is most probably they have asked us the answer. Here, if you can clearly see that both the air conduction and bone conduction, it is dipped at 4 kilohertz. This is typically seen in noise induced hearing loss. So, question number 279, answer is C. That is, it is a noise trauma or noise induced hearing loss. Now, this is also known as acoustic dip, or it is also known as boiler's notch. And there are some other reasons of downsloping hearing loss. You can see that in presbyacusis, by downsloping I means that there is a loss not in the lower frequency, but there is a loss in the higher frequencies. So in presbyacusis and ototoxicity along with noise trauma, there is a downsloping curve. Down sloping audiogram or down sloping curve. So, there is a very nice mnemonic also in this, that is known as POND. P stands for presbyacusis, O stands for ototoxicity, and N stands for noise induced hearing loss, and D stands for down sloping. Now, there is, if you see the option A, that is otosclerosis. In otosclerosis, we see a typical notch we see a typical notch in otosclerosis, which is known as Cahart's notch. And in Cahart's notch, there is a dip only in bone conduction. There is a dip only in bone conduction at 2 kilohertz. And this notch, it is not diagnostic that it will be present in all cases of otosclerosis. And this notch can be removed by doing a successfully surgery, successful stapedotomy. And so otosclerosis, we can see a Cahart's notch. And as I told you in presbycusis, also there will be a downsloping curve. But this dip in both the air conduction and bone conduction, 4 kilohertz, is typical of noise-induced hearing loss. Now, coming to the next question, it's a figure-based question again. A 21-year-old man presents with sore throat. He also complains of dysphagia, odynophagia, and otalgia. His temperature is 102.5 Fahrenheit. The patient speaks with a hot potato voice and is drooling. This is very important for us. The patient is drooling and is having a hot potato voice. Means patient is not able to swallow his saliva even. That's why he's drooling. Examination of the throat reveals a hypertrophied right tonsil that appears to displace inferiorly and medially. If you see the image, the tonsil is displaced inferiorly and medially. There is a contralateral deflection of the uvula. If you see, the uvula is also deflected, and the patient is having trismus with cervical lymphadenopathy. The most likely diagnosis here is, this is a peritonsillar abscess. So, question number 280. Answer is B, that is peritonsillar abscess. Now, peritonsillar abscess is also known as Quincy. It is nothing but it is the accumulation of pus between capsule of the tonsil and the superior constrictor muscle. So Quincy is accumulation of pus between the capsule of the tonsil and the superior constrictor muscle, and it is almost always unilateral. All the features which have been described in the questions, they are typical of Quincy. Like, there will be a hot potato voice, there will be a fever, cervical lymphadenopathy, there will be a trismus because of the spasm in the medial pterygoid, so there will be a trismus. The uvula, the tonsil will be pushed medially so much that the uvula is, it's a sign. It is not a symptom. So you see, that is a sign. So uvula is displaced to opposite side. And the patient complains of otalgia, dysphagia, as well as odynophagia. Now you can ask me that all these symptoms can be present in the other option which are given, the other option being retropharyngeal abscess. How will you differentiate between the retropharyngeal abscess and Quincy? First of all, Quincy is a unilateral thing. So you can see the tonsil is displaced medially. In case of retropharyngeal, the posterior pharyngeal wall will be displaced anteriorly, so there will not be any displacement of the tonsil, number one point. Number two point, in case of retropharyngeal abscess, there will be some element of torticollis. The torticollis will be the spasm of the spinal muscle. So patient will be having a torticollis, which is not happening with this patient. And patient will also be having some kind of stridor, breathing difficulty, or some other kind of respiratory distress. So retropharyngeal abscess is ruled out in this patient. Now, other option which is given is exudative pharyngitis. Exudative pharyngitis will be bilateral condition. if the tonsils is getting enlarged, the patient is having fever, sore throat, all these things, cervical lymphadenopathy. So it is a bilateral condition. It is not a unilateral condition. And the last option which is given is cancer of the right tonsil. So if the cancer of the right tonsil will be present, we can see ulcero proliferative growth on the tonsil, which is not seen here. So the answer is peritonsillar abscess, that is, it is also known as Quincy. And what happens if the patient develops Quincy? We start the patient on IV antibiotics and we do IND, that is incision and drainage. Now, incision and drainage will be done at the junction of, we draw a line, imaginary line from the base of uvula and from the anterior tonsil, just lateral to this point. We give a stab with a guided, we have a guided knife for draining the Quincy abscess. So we just drain this abscess, and subsequently to prevent this, patient has to undergo a tonsillectomy. It is, if a patient is a child, so following one episode of Quincy, the child must undergo interval tonsillectomy. This is known as interval tonsillectomy because it is done after about 6 weeks. This is also MCQ. We wait for roughly about 6 weeks. And if it is an adult, we do after 2 episodes. So this was about the treatment of Quincy. Now coming to question number 281, labyrinthine artery is a branch of. Now labyrinthine artery is a branch of anterior inferior cerebellar artery, that is option D. So 281, anterior inferior cerebellar artery, that is ICA. So ICA gives a branch which is known as labyrinthine artery. Now it arises from ICA in about 85 to 100% of the cases, but in less than 15% of the cases it can also arise from basilar artery. And it supplies the whole of the inner ear. So answer is D, that is the anterior inferior cerebellar artery. Now coming to an image based question, question number 282. They have asked what is the instrument which has been held in the hand. So it is a Jobson Horn probe, that is 282. Answer is A, Jobson Horn probe. Now Jobson Horn probe is the most commonly used instrument in a OPD of an otolaryngologist, and it is something like this, that it has at one end the edges are serrated. This is when we use the cotton to make a wisp while cleaning the middle ear or the external ear, and on the other hand there is a ring. This ring is basically used to remove the impacted wax or the impacted foreign body. So the answer is Jobson Horn probe. Now coming to question number 283, stapedial reflex is mediated by. The stapedial reflex is a reflex, it is a protective reflex, and it is mediated by the afferent is the 8th nerve and the efferent is the 7th nerve. So if you see the option, it is answer is D, stapedial reflex. Now few point about it very fast. Stapedial reflex is also known as acoustic reflex. Basically, it is a protective reflex and it is a bilateral or consensual reflex. That means if the ear of one side is stimulated by the sound, so the other ear stapes will also contract. So the afferent is 8th nerve and the efferent is the 7th nerve or the facial nerve. So what happens is when the sound is given to the ear, the sound is perceived by the cochlea and it is then sent to the brainstem, and brainstem then stimulates the facial nerve nuclei, which then stimulates the stapedial muscle, and stapedial muscle contracts and it fixes the stapes on the oval window, so tightened so that the harmful effect of the loud noise is protective. So it acts as a dampening of loud sound. So that's why it is also known as protective reflex. And there is a threshold to it. The threshold is that it is seen about 70 to 100 dB above SPL. And there is latency also. It takes minimum time of around 25 milliseconds for this reflex to be activated, 25 milliseconds to 150 milliseconds. So it is a protective reflex. It is also known as attenuation or acoustic reflex. And afferent is 8th nerve, efferent is 7th nerve. Threshold is around 70 to 100 dB above SPL, and latency is 25 millisecond to 150 millisecond. So if a sudden burst is given to an individual, that can cause harm to his inner ear. But thanks to this reflex, that it acts within 25 milliseconds, within fraction of seconds, to protect the inner ear. Now coming to the next question, question number 284. Question number 284 states, that is also an image-based question. Here we can see it's a tympanogram which has been shown in the image, and a type of graph is also written, type AS. You can see in AS the compliance is very low. Here on the x-axis we can see the pressure has been posted, and on the y-axis the compliance is there. So we can see the pressure is, or the compliance is very low. That is at ambient atmosphere. At normal pressure, it is having a low compliance. So this is seen typically in otosclerosis. So answer over here is, answer is A, that is otosclerosis. Now other type of curves, like type A, it is a normal tympanogram. It is seen in ear which is normal. Type AS, like in this, is seen in otosclerosis. Here what happens is the compliance is low. The compliance is low, so there is an impedance of, you know, sound passing through the tympanic membrane. Whereas in type AD, there is a high compliance. And AD is seen in ossicular discontinuity, or when there is a lax tympanic membrane. There is one more type C curve which is seen in a retracted TM, where the pressure in the middle ear cavity is less, so the TM is retracted. So that is known as, this is basically because of the Eustachian tube dysfunction. So retracted TM, we can see a type C curve. And type B curve is seen in, it is a flat curve. It is seen in secretory otitis media is also when the fluid is present behind the behind tympanic membrane. So here we can see a type AS curve, and it is typically because of the lower compliance, and lower compliance is seen in otosclerosis. That is because of the stiffening of the stapes. The stapes doesn't move on the oval window. Now, question number 285 is also image-based question. Here, we can see that there is a picture of endolarynx, and we can see two small bumps which are present at the junction of the anterior one-third and posterior two-third. And the patient complains of hoarseness, vocal fatigue, and pain in the neck on prolonged phonation. The diagnosis is. So you can see, typically see small two bumps. This is vocal nodules. So question number 285. Answer is D, that is vocal nodules. Vocal nodules are present, they are symmetrical, they are present at junction of anterior one-third and posterior two-third of the membranous vocal cord. Why they are present here? Because this is the area of maximum vibration. So when the vocal cords are vibrating, this is the area of maximum vibration. So vocal nodules are present at the junction of anterior one-third and posterior two-third. Typically, the patient presents with vocal fatigue. Hoarseness and sometimes the pain in the neck. The treatment of this is, patient should be, it is typically seen in, as you know, it is seen in singers and teachers and those profession who require using of voice more. So the treatment initially, if it is a soft bumpy nodule, or it is, if it is not matured enough, if it is reddish in color, we should go for speech therapy. Initially, we should go for speech therapy, and if it has matured and become whitish in color, then there is no option rather than to go for micro laryngeal surgery. So here the answer is D, vocal nodules. Now coming to question number 286, this is also image-based question, and internal nasal wall is being shown in the given image. Choose the incorrect statement. Now, the internal nasal wall is the narrowest area of the nose. This is the first and foremost thing which comes to my mind, at least when I think of the internal nasal wall. So if you see the first option, that is also, that is the incorrect statement. So hence that is the answer. Option number A states it's the widest portion of the nostril. It is not the widest portion of the nostril, it is the narrowest portion of the nostril. So question number 286, answer is A, widest portion of nostril or the nasal cavity. Rest other choices which are given are correct. It is responsible for sinus ventilation, it is responsible for parabolic nasal flow, and the upper edge of the lower lateral cartilage is an important boundary. Here, there is a small change, there is a small correction. It is not the upper edge, but it is the lower edge of the lower edge of the upper lateral cartilage. So just to clarify, I'll just draw a diagram. So it should be the lower edge of the lower edge of the upper lateral cartilage. So question number 286, boundaries of internal nasal valve. Medially, it's the nasal septum. Above, it is the lower edge of upper lateral cartilage, and there is also the anterior end of the inferior turbinate, and it forms an angle. The angle is more than 10 to less than 15 degree. So internal nasal wall, it is responsible for the parabolic nasal flow, it is responsible for the sinus ventilation, and the lower edge of the lower lateral cartilage, of the upper lateral cartilage, along with the septum and the anterior end of turbinate, forms the nasal valve area, and the angle is between 10 to 15 degree. So answer over here is A. We have to tell the incorrect option. So answer is A, that is, it is the widest portion of the nostril.